Philharmonic. Do you remember your first performance as a soloist with the orchestra?
Yes. It was a Debussy Rhapsody. And it was in 1961. And we were still in Carnegie Hall then. There was no Lincoln Center yet. That would be another year down the road for the first building to go up at Lincoln Center, Philharmonic Hall. And these performances were in Carnegie Hall. And after those five performances, we recorded the Rhapsody. And it was recorded in a ballroom at Manhattan Center, which was a venue that Columbia Records used for recording because it had a great sound. And that was the first one. And the next recording I did with the Philharmonic as soloist was, I guess it was the Nielsen Concerto, the Carl Nielsen Concerto.
That recording is now part of clarinet folklore. Legend has it that this concerto was recorded in one take. Tell us about the recording and about the live performances around that time.
Well, we performed it for a 10-day period, in a 10-day period prior to the recording. Bernstein was doing a Nielsen festival of sorts over two seasons, and the recording was done on the stage of Avery Fisher Hall, Philharmonic Hall, and which became the recording venue for the orchestra when the hall was completed. And in actuality, for my part, it was a one-take recording. There was one patch in the 3/8 section that begins with the strings, and there was a glitch they had to fix in the section that begins da 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 di do di do di do da da ba da 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 di do di do da 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 da, 3/8 section, but that's the only insert. But I didn't think they wanted to spend too much money on a clarinet player. You know, I mean, it's not like I was Heifetz playing the Beethoven concerto, but it's a recording I'm very proud of, actually. And I think the next recording was the Corigliano concerto, and that was a commission work that Leonard Bernstein conducted, and we played it in, I think it was in 1977, in December.
What was the genesis of that commission? Talk about that a little bit.
Well, one of the board members was commissioning works for the Philharmonic, for the principal players. And I was asked by the managing director, who would you like to write a concerto for you? Well, I said Leonard Bernstein. And he said, that's a good answer. But I don't think, I'll ask him, he said. I'm not sure. So he asked Bernstein, not in my presence, of course, when he saw him. Bernstein said he couldn't have it for the following season, but he wants to conduct it, and he recommended John Corigliano Jr., who I had known. His father was concertmaster. That's how it came to be, that John wrote the piece and Leonard Bernstein conducted it, and it got very popular, I guess, for a while, because I was playing it with a lot of other orchestras. As a matter of fact, I played it not so long ago with the Louisiana Philharmonic as a benefit for the Katrina hurricane.
The Corigliano Concerto is devilishly difficult. It's rumored that you didn't receive the last movement until 3 weeks before the premiere.
Well, I would say that's how it happened. I got a movement at a time, but you see, there was an added difficulty that there was no piano reduction, so one really couldn't absorb the entire piece in your own private practice, but. it was, I would say, it was probably the most exciting week of my life. From the first rehearsal of that piece to the performance, to the world premiere performance at the end of that week, it was amazing. So it's a piece that really had staying power and is in the repertoire today.
Now you recorded the concerto twice. Would you talk about
Yes.
both of those recordings?
Well, the world premiere live recording with Bernstein. And 3 years later, in a studio recording from the stage of Avery Fisher Hall with the Zubin Mehta conducting, and that was I got a Grammy nomination for that recording with Zubin, as I did for my last recording with the Philharmonic, which we can talk about.
Let's talk about the next commission the Philharmonic made for you. Concerto by William Bolcom.
Right. That was for, I think, the 150th anniversary of the Philharmonic. That was a fun piece. It had little elements of swing in the first movement. The second movement was very unusual. It started with a tuba solo, and it sounded like a wonderful melody from a slow movement of a sonata. And the last movement was a drunken waltz. With circus effects and tremendously high notes and a lot of articulation. It really, I'd say, a great audience piece. It's a piece that probably should be played more than it is. That was conducted by Leonard Slatkin, who was the music director of the St. Louis Orchestra at the time, I believe. So that recording is in their boxed set of American works, and the live Corigliano premiere is in the box set of the historic broadcasts, and I'm in very good company in that. There's some very famous people that are soloists in that box set, so I'm doubly honored.
So you're very, very closely associated with Aaron Copland's Clarinet Concerto.
Yes.
Having performed it, how many
well,
times?
Well, they say 59 or 60 times, with a number of different conductors. I did it on TV with Bernstein for a young people's concert. The concert was a Happy Birthday, Aaron Copland. It was in the early 1970s. And one of the early color TVs broadcasts of a young people's concert. The interesting, bittersweet story about the Copland Concerto is that I played it the last time Leonard Bernstein came as a guest conductor to the Philharmonic in October of 1989. He was a guest for 2 weeks, where he did all Tchaikovsky 1 week and all Copland 1 week, and I was his last soloist in his visit to the Philharmonic. And that recording also got a Grammy nomination. Now, a few months after that recording of Copland Concerto with Bernstein, I was invited to be a part of the international orchestra that went to Berlin to play the Freedom Concert from East Berlin. When the Berlin Wall was being dismantled, was coming down, and I joined this international orchestra he created to play the Beethoven Ninth Symphony in East Berlin. It was televised all over the world. It was a very moving experience, and that's the last time I saw him. He died a few months after that.
You had so many memorable solo performances with the Philharmonic, some planned, some unplanned.
Yeah, I know what you mean. I know what you. I did a sort of a jumping in situation a couple of times. One was when a famous soloist, the soprano, got sick, and I had come to the hall an hour before, as I usually did, to prepare, to warm up, and so forth. And the dressing room, there was a phone call from the from the management of the orchestra, that would I consider playing the Mozart clarinet concerto at the concert that which was going to start, you know, an hour and a half hence. And I said, sure. They said, Zubin asked us to call you, Zubin Mehta, and to see if you were willing to do that. This is without rehearsal, mind you. But what they didn't tell me was, what I didn't tell them was that I didn't have an A clarinet with me at the hall, but my colleague and friend, Mitchell Estrin, lived nearby, and he had an A clarinet, of course, a very good one. I called him up, and with luck, he happened to be in his apartment, and I said, Mitchell, please get here as fast as you can with your A clarinet. So I played the Copland, I played the Mozart concerto with Zubin without rehearsal on Mitchell Estrin's A clarinet. I think it was better than my A clarinet, actually. That's one of the times I jumped in. I've had to jump in a few times in the orchestra when a colleague didn't show up for one reason or another. One was not so long ago in my final season where it was the Shostakovich violin concerto, which I hadn't played since the premiere in 1954, when David Oistrakh came and played the new concerto of Shostakovich, the Metropolis conducted. The program was a split week with, there were two different programs that week, and I guess my colleague who was scheduled to play in that concerto didn't show up, and I had to run out on stage after I'd been off the stage waiting for the next part of the concert, the principal work that was in the second half, and came on and played in the orchestra for the Shostakovich concerto, which is not an easy feat, but I was lucky. I nailed it, and my blood pressure, I guess it was all right.
So of the standard repertoire pieces, what are some of the favorites that you have to play as a solo clarinetist in an orchestra?
Well, you know, everybody knows the audition solos. Those are all great, you know, the famous ones. You know, when you get to play some of the solos that you don't play that often, perhaps, maybe like the First Symphony of Sibelius that opens with a clarinet alone, you know, or one of the Nielsen symphonies, the Fifth Symphony, has a wonderful writing for clarinet. Or some of the Verdi excerpts that have prominent solos. But the famous solos, the Capriccio Espanol and the Scheherazade and the Rachmaninoff Second Symphony, those are special, you know. And then once in a while you get something that you never heard of that also is very, very interesting, taxing, and in some cases very beautiful. But you look forward to certain works.
Now, you've recorded everything orchestrally. What are some of your favorite recordings, personal favorites?
Well, you know, there was an era of recording where everything was recorded constantly. Every week there'd be hours and hours of recording. I've done cycles of things, all the Sibelius symphonies, all of the Brahms, all of the Beethoven, all of the Mahler, all the Nielsen symphonies, just incredible works. I mean, there are so many highlight recordings. The Tenth Symphony of Shostakovich was one with Metropolis. The Mahlers with Bernstein, the Bruno Walter and the Brahms symphonies. You know, I mean, there are any number of highlight recordings that had meaning and special moments.